It seems that great crises produce great men and great deeds of courage. The United States had known no greater crisis than that which culminated in the fratricidal war between the North and the South. The old Senate chamber was the cockpit in which was fought the struggle to preserve the Union. Some sought compromises which would postpone or remove the shadow of war which hung over the nation. For them, it was an agonizing decision. For the ultimate choice involved breaking of old ties of loyalty and friendship, and the prospect of humiliating political defeat. Senator Thomas Hart Benton of Missouri was faced with such a decision in 1850.
Welcome, Senator. I'm from the Gazette. Senator, on your speaking tour through Missouri, you stirred up considerable controversy.
I always stir up controversy, sir. Whenever a man speaks the truth, he stirs up a holler. You must try it sometime. It never fails.
Senator, are you aware that John Lynch has filed a suit for libel against you?
I am aware, sir, that he filed a suit. As to the specific charges, no, pardon me.
Well, he says you called him a wife beater.
That I did, sir. Beats his wife regularly.
And he said you called him a cur dog.
A low cur dog were my exact words, sir. I called him that, among other things. L-O-W-C-U-R. However, since these facts are generally known, I cannot see that another assertion of the facts constitutes libel.
It begins, Senator.
Thank you, sir!
One last question, Senator. How do you respond to the rumor of Stephen Douglas for president?
Douglas can never be president, sir. No, sir, Douglas can never be president.
On what do you base that judgment, Senator?
His legs are too short, sir. His coat, like the cow's tail, hangs too close to the ground, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Thomas Hart Benton, Senator from Missouri.
Thank you. Citizens, I have received certain resolutions from the Missouri legislature denying Congress the right to legislate upon the subject of slavery in the territories. I have also been instructed to vote in conformity to those resolutions. Instructed. Now, citizens, I ask you to turn your eyes westward to the great territory of California, with all its great wealth and natural resources. Do you want California to become a part of our nation? Then these resolutions must be repudiated. I thank you. Well, a good speech, Mr. Blair. If I do say so myself, sir. Good speech.
Yes, a good speech.
Those are my people out there. This is my home, sir. I talk to them, they understand. Now, that's something you can put in your newspaper. I talk to them, they cheer. And when people are cheering, they understand.
Senator, you go on as if the opposition simply weren't there.
Opposition?
Now, consider the threat that Atchison made. He said he'd isolate you. He has. He said you'd never get enough votes to return to the Senate. Well, he's doing that, too. Quietly, insidiously, effectively. While you travel the countryside listening to a few people cheer, he is crushing every chance you ever had.
Public opinion.
You're not elected by public opinion. You're not elected by the votes of the people. You are elected by the members of the legislature. Now, how many assemblymen have come to hear you speak? How many have you heard cheer?
They elected me before, and they're gonna do it again.
You were part of the political machine then, a member of the party. Now you're an outsider. You stand alone.
The people's are...
The people are not going to help. Can't you see what you're asking? You're asking them to take a position on slavery. And the majority of them don't want to take a position.
They have got to take a position, sir.
Senator, this train is taking us into southern Missouri. You're not going to hear any cheers there. People don't want to be forced into taking a stand. They search for postponement or truce, or out-and-out abdication of responsibility. That's what Atchison offers, and that's what they're accepting.
And does that lead you to believe that I'm defeated already?
I believe, Senator, that after the legislature casts its votes in the next election, you will be recalled.
Ah. And branded forever as a traitor, apostate, scoundrel, etc., and what have you. And what is your advice, Mr. Blair? What should I do? Withdraw?
I know you won't do that.
You're right, sir. Benton never withdraws.
Father. Father, we're home. You must rest for a few days now. You're very tired.
Jesse, I never get tired. Jesse, I'm going to win. And you take an issue to the people and explain it to them. Or sometimes I've had to act against the preconceived opinions and the first impressions of my constituents. But always with full reliance on their intelligence to understand me and their equity to do me justice. Never have been disappointed.
I'm sure they understood.
You tell me I'm popular in Missouri. I value solid popularity. The esteem of good men for good action. And I despise that bubble popularity that's won without merit and lost without crime. So if I lose, I had it to do.
He had it to do, and he lost all. 7 years later, Thomas Hart Benton was dead. He died still fighting for those things which he believed. His last whispered words were, "I am comfortable, I am content." But even in death and defeat, Thomas Hart Benton was victorious. His voice from the past in behalf of Union was one of the deciding factors that prevented Missouri from seceding, despite all the desperate efforts to drive her to do so, along with her sister slave states.